Today I want to discuss MOVE semantics, which is just an abbreviation of resource ownership transfer between objects. That's quite a mouthful, and we will look at it by re-implementing or looking at a re-implementation of unique pointer from the standard library, but quite simplified. Before we dive into the code, let's look at a diagram to understand this resource ownership transfer a bit better. So in C++, it's quite usual to have objects being responsible for external resources by having an internal handle to it. So, for example, this resource could be heap memory or a file handle or a mutex or an OpenGL texture, something like that. And then inside the destructor of this object, the resource will be automatically released, provided that we write something sensible in the destructor, right? So when this object goes out of scope, the resource will be released. We don't have to do it manually. That's always a good idea in C++. Okay, so oftentimes these resources are non-copyable by nature. So for example, what would it mean to copy a mutex or copy a file handle? That doesn't really make sense. So if we simply made a flat copy of the C++ object, then we would get something like this. This handle, so for example, a pointer in many cases will simply be copied. When the first object goes out of scope, the resource is released, then it's gone. Further uses of the resource through the second handle will lead to undefined behavior. And when the second object goes out of scope, then the resource will be released again, and that will definitely invoke undefined behavior again. So definitely not a good idea. What we want to do instead is say, okay, sometimes we have one object which handles a resource or has ownership of a resource, and we want to transfer that ownership to a second object, and that would look like this. Okay, so the important part is that the original object no longer has a handle on the resource, so when the destructor is called, nothing happens, and the second object can still access the resource. Okay, and what you see here, going from this diagram to this diagram, this is MOVE semantics. And note that no figure on the screen is moving anywhere, right? So neither the resource is moved nor the objects are moved in memory. It's maybe really not the best name. It means first one object is responsible for a resource, and after the move, another object is responsible for the resource. That's all it means. It has nothing to do with moving memory. Okay. So let's go back to the code. What do we have here? So we have a class template called unique pointer, just like in the standard library, which just encapsulates a raw C pointer, presumably pointing to heap memory. Okay, then we have a constructor which takes such a pointer as a parameter and then simply initializes the field with the parameter. And in case we don't provide a parameter, we use null pointer as the default. Okay, and then some useful debug output just to understand what's going on better. Okay, then we have two deletions of the copy constructor and the copy assignment operator. I discussed that in the previous video. That's so copy construction like this and assignment like this doesn't take place, because that would lead again to this situation where multiple objects share the same resource. We don't want to do that. Okay, so we should get nice error messages here. Use of deleted function for the B case, that's the copy constructor here, and then use of deleted function for the C case, that's the assignment operator here. Okay, cool. But of course, what we can do is initialize B with some other raw pointer, and then we should get some sensible output here. So here we can see A is initialized with new int 42, B is initialized with new int 97, and then B is destroyed, and then A is destroyed, and their destructors delete the respective raw pointers in reverse order again, right? That's the stack-based nature of C++ stack allocation. Okay, cool. Right, so we don't want to allow, you know, stuff like A equals B. Why do we not want to allow it? Because, you know, if we implement this MOVE semantics that looks like this, then we would be quite surprised if after this line, accessing B would be illegal, right? So we really only want to move from objects that we can no longer use after the move anyway, for example, temporary objects. So if we say, let's initialize A with unique pointer int new int 42, for example, like this, then this is not a variable, right? I can't go in the second line and write the same expression and expect this to be the same object as above, because after the semicolon, this temporary is destroyed anyway, right? So there's no way to access it again after the move anyway. Okay, but this still won't work, of course, because C++ still thinks we want to copy from here into A, and we have to write a special constructor to now enable this move semantics. And this is not the copy constructor, but the without const. Let me copy unique pointer. It's such a mouthful. The move constructor looks like this. Okay, so the parameter is not const because if we look at the diagram, if you look at what move semantics does, this is the parameter of the move constructor. And after moving, we have obviously changed its state, right? So we have to somehow modify the handle. That's why we can't make it const. And this double ampersand reads R value reference. So this will only bind to R values such as this expression, but not to L values such as variable names. Okay, maybe first a debug output so we don't forget that. So maybe let's do another new line here because the moves are so interesting. And then we have to print the address of that to the terminal so it makes more sense. And then, yeah, so we have to copy the pointer first. So after that line, we have in the diagram the situation where we just copied the pointer into the new object. Okay, but we want to get here, so we have to set the original pointer to null. Okay, so that would be the null pointer, right? So this is the essence of move semantics. Copy the handle from the old object into the new object and then set the handle to null because we want the destructor to not do anything with the moved from object, right? So if the destructor runs on this object, nothing should happen. And since the handle is null, nothing will happen. Delete null pointer is a perfectly fine operation in C++. It simply doesn't do anything. Okay, so this is really important here. Okay, cool. Right, so let's see if that works and what the output is. Okay, so that's looking quite good. So this is the temporary unique pointer that you see here. Okay, we initialize it with new int 42. And then we move it, we move the temporary object into A. Right, so this is the move constructor in action here. We don't copy into A, we move into A. Okay, and then the temporary is destroyed, but we don't have to do anything here because we just set the pointer to null pointer during the move. Right, so you can see the source of the move destroying it is a no-op. And finally, when A goes out of scope, then we delete the new int 42. Right, so you can see initially the owner of new int 42 was the FE08 object, and then the ownership was transferred, and then the deletion was done by the FE00 object. That's also a nice visualization of move semantics here. Okay, cool. Maybe that's quite a contrived example. Maybe it would be more useful to have a function call here that would return a unique pointer of int. Let's write f, of course, and then we simply return this object. Okay. Right, and then this works, and now we have two moves. Why do we have two moves? Because first the temporary is moved into the function call, right? So we have to move the result from here to the call side. And then the second move will move the object from the call side into the variable that we want to initialize. Okay? So of course, without this special command line argument, I think both moves, or at least one of them, will be moved optimized away completely. But for the purposes of education, I think this is a nice command line switch. Okay, cool. Yeah, and maybe let's make the example even less real world. What happens if we take the unique pointer as a parameter? Let's call it, I don't know, temp. And then return that. And let's see if we pass it in there. Does that still work? Yeah, and now we have three moves. Why do we have three moves? Because the temporary object here at the call site has to be moved into the temp parameter. That's the first guy. Then temp has to be moved back to the call site. That's this guy. And then the result has to be moved into A. That's this guy. Right? And then we have here three no-op deletions, and the final one actually deletes the resource or releases the resource. Yeah, that's quite cool. Okay. Now let's say for some reason we want to write something like this. So this still won't be allowed. The compiler will say that the copy constructor was deleted, and it won't invoke the move constructor here because, yeah, we could use A again in the second line, and we would be very surprised if this line would somehow change A. If we promise to the compiler that we're not going to use A in the lines below, and we're perfectly fine if the compiler decided to invoke the move constructor, then we have to enable that, right? So A is an L value. This R value reference doesn't bind to L values, it only binds to R values. So we have to somehow cast A into an R value. And we can do that with a static cast to a unique pointer of int R value reference of A. That should work. Yeah, that works. Okay, let me, so we don't get a compiler error. That's fine. I guess that would be this move here. Okay, and here you can see A is deleted. That doesn't do anything. Yeah, that's looking good. And this is the B that was deleted first. Yeah, so that definitely works. That's cool. Okay, but of course, this is quite a mouthful, right? Nobody wants to write this static cast angle brackets, repeat the type, and then these double ampersands. Ugh. Can't we have a standard library function template for that? And indeed we can, and it's called, I'm really sad about the name, it's called standard move. It causes no end of confusion. It would be much better if it was called, you know, R value cast, whoops, or something like enable move, but it's called move. I can't change the name. Okay, so standard move A doesn't really do anything. So in particular, this doesn't call the move constructor. It simply says, if this expression is used in a context where an R value reference would be useful, for example, by initializing a new variable, then the move constructor will be called. Right? So if you just have this line on your own, then nothing will happen at runtime. Okay, so that's an important distinction. Okay, and what's interesting is that you don't need the standard move here. So here the compiler is smart enough to figure out, hey, if you return a local variable that's going to be destroyed anyway, then that's a similar case to, you know, a temporary object like here. You don't have to write standard move. Right? You could. That would prevent some better optimizations that I disabled here. So you really shouldn't move from local variables, from automatic variables on the stack. Okay, cool. So one thing that I haven't showed you, maybe you want to, you know, move back from A to B, that won't compile because we deleted the copy assignment operator. There is something called the move assignment operator. It looks similar to, you know, it takes the same thing as the move constructor, and the rest looks similar as the copy assignment operator. And this is quite complicated to implement. So I'm not going to do it in this video. Maybe it's an exercise left to the viewer. I think it will muddy the waters too much with some unnecessary complexity for this video. But be aware it exists and it can be implemented in various ways. Okay, so the basic takeaway is you have to distinguish between L values such as variable names and R values such as expressions that evaluate to temporaries. So function calls, for example, that return by value, those function calls are also R values. And then the move semantics will work automatically. The only case where you have to write standard move is if you say, I have a named variable and this is the last time I'm going to use it. I promise, dear compiler, please move from it if you can. And this will trigger the move constructor in, you know, for the whole context here. Okay, so I hope this video got the main point across. Of course, if you want to dig deeper, there are good internet resources available. But I think the basic problem of saying, I want unique ownership of a resource, I don't want shared ownership to a resource, which would lead to double freeze and deletes. I want to move the resource from one object to another. That should hopefully have become clear by watching this video. And the rest is just details as often.